This is an MPB Think Radio podcast.
Do you drive a vehicle? Then you'll find autocorrect helpful, especially on Coach Charlie's Tip of the Week. Listen to our podcast with me, Coach Charlie Melton, on any podcasting platform or on the MPB Public Media app.
From MPB Think Radio, this is Now You're Talking, a show about the most interesting people and stories in Mississippi. I'm your host, Marshall Ramsey. I'm editor-at-large and editorial cartoonist with Mississippi Today. Now, with the stroke of a brush, my next guest, Egg McGowan, has impacted the world of art as a painter and a sculptor, whose work has been installed and exhibited in numerous galleries and museums and public spaces all around the globe. He's a 2023 recipient of the Governor's Arts Awards Lifetime Achievement Honor. He's also a graduate of the University of Southern Mississippi and proudly hailed from Hattiesburg, Mississippi. Ed McGowan joins me today to discuss his noteworthy career, his life in New York, and how awesome it is to change his name 12 times, which I think is just, I mean, I remember one now, I got to say that Jermaine has had to change her name before, and I never have changed my name. Now, I'm in witness protection, but I've never had to do that with the editorial cartoons. But I did change my address one time, and that was a complete pain. So, yeah, I'm really looking forward to this interview.
Me too. Yeah. I'm excited about it.
This is going to be fun. And I'd be honest with you, I'm going to do this interview today kind of not as much with my radio hat on as much as I am as my artist hat on, because I'm a big fan of your work and of your career, and I was very excited to see that you were received the Lifetime Achievement Award this year. And not only that, you came in with an incredibly strong class this year too, with some great folks. So congratulations right off the top.
Thank you very much. I was very honored and very honored to be on this show. It's great to talk to you.
Well, that's good. I hope you feel honored by the time we get done. You know, you never know. You want to set the expectations low at the beginning of the interview, but I am a fan. And like I said, you know, as somebody who's 30 years behind you on the calendar anyway, I've just loved the way your career has unfolded and structured. And it's been a wonderful combination of a little bit of luck, but an awful lot of hard work too. And I guess talk a little bit about, you know, family and the influences, your parents. They started out in New Orleans. You were born in Hattiesburg, then you moved to Alabama. But there seemed to be a lot of things along the way that kind of influenced you and kind of pushed you into the arts.
Well, that's all true. My parents met in New Orleans during the Depression and got married, and I was born in Hattiesburg, but then the family moved over to Alabama for a while and then came back to Hattiesburg. The influence from the family influence was largely my mother and her father. Her father, a man named Albert Ratliff, was sort of a entrepreneur and artist and jack of all trades. He did everything. And one of the things I like most about being with my grandfather, we were around each other all the time, was he was a professional sign painter, and he could he made, you know, beautiful script on drugstore windows and whatever, and watching the words flow out of the end of his brush was magic for a kid. So watching him and knowing about his inventions and his his creativity in a way made it possible for me to look at that as something that was an interesting way to go through life. So there was not an awful lot of art education or museums or galleries or anything in Mississippi when I was a young boy. So mother brought home books and had magazines that she ordered so that I could see art. But most of it was, I think, inspired by watching my grandfather. He was really quite a character.
That whole art form of sign painting, and you almost hate to see that it's gone, but in a way, just seeing the new murals that are popping up everywhere and seeing that kind of, in a way, come back, But my grandmother was a China painter. And, you know, people always say, well, did she sit down and teach you anything? And it's like, not that I remember. And I can't paint flowers to save my life now. But just the magic of watching her create and everything, I was like, I want to do that someday. And that had to be just a huge boost. Now, didn't he do, like, displays for drugstores and things like that, too?
He did. He was, a very creative guy, and he used to, in drugstores, you know, back in the 40s, the local drugstores, there was no Walgreens or any of those around, you know, where we lived, and so the local drugstores would hire people in some cases to make these kinetic or movable displays in their window.
Oh, cool.
And they were very cool. And they would have themes, you know, like I can't remember anything specifically, but let's say that you'd do a Little Red Riding Hood theme and make, you know, a house and a train that ran through it with Little Red Riding Hood and on and on and on, you know, very, very interesting stuff. And it was all handmade, hand painted. And it was all the mechanics of it, which was really Rube Goldberg, wonderful. That was what fascinated me a great deal, because they had to work. You know, they couldn't break down. They would work. They would go in the window and they would stay there until the drugstore decided to change that and go to something else.
That's incredible. Did any of those pieces ever survive? Do you have any of his work?
I do not, and I don't have anything that he made.
Oh, wow.
Which is just, you know, heartbreaking. But at the time, I was more or less a grown man before I really thought about being an artist seriously. And I mean, I used to do the decorations for stuff and that, you know, that sort of stuff. But I didn't think about it as a career. I was supposed to go to Annapolis, and my roommate went to Annapolis and didn't come back. So I'm glad I didn't go there.
Yeah, I mean, it was like literally you went to like prep school. You were thrown in a bunch of engineering and everything, and apparently you discovered pretty quickly that being a soldier wasn't a thing for you.
It wasn't going to work out, you know.
Or sailor.
And not that I didn't try. I mean, I tried very hard. I was just no good at it. And I say my good friend that I roomed with became a fighter pilot. And,
oh, wow.
And didn't make it back. It was he did come back, actually, but died shortly after that. Nevertheless, the opportunities to consider art were pretty much zero when I was a kid, and so I loved watching what my grandfather did and taking that as a clue.
Well, that's the thing that amazed me about your story, and I'm sitting here, you know, listening to you say there, you know, the Lauren Rogers Museum was about the only thing that was there, you know, in Mississippi at the time, and now when you think about how many museums we've got in the state, and the Mississippi Museum of Art, of course, they have a big collection of your work now, but they're fantastic, and it's just, it's kind of neat to see how far we've come in the state when it comes to appreciation of art as well.
It really has. It is absolutely miraculous. I mean, if New York came as far as Mississippi came in that period of time, it would be no room for anybody else, because as much art is available in New York when compared to none in Mississippi, or relatively none in Mississippi, it really has made an enormous advance, and all of the artists that I know there that I knew and worked with, Bill Dunlap and Keith Francis, Thornton Willis, Jennifer Torres down at Mississippi Southern, and thousands more are really working on very, you know, very interesting high class, high top drawer pieces. I think being an artist in Mississippi is a whole different option now, and it's not the least of that is the untrained artist. I mean, the artists that you know, the commonly called folk artists, those people are that's the richest source of that work that you can just about anywhere you can find. And
I know you and your wife Claudia have collected that throughout the years, and you made a huge donation of your folk art collection as well. And it's just such great storytelling that you see with their work.
Oh, it is. Truly is. Yeah, it's just great. I think an awful lot of us, I mean, we were, when I was at the University of Alabama in graduate school, one of our professors trained us on that. He took us to see folk artists, you know, and then saw the relationship between that and expressionism and so forth. So that's good stuff there.
So when you were at Southern Miss, or at the time, you thought, well, since I've got the engineering background, I'll do the math. But you one day found your way into the art department, and obviously we would not be talking right now if you had not done that.
Right.
You obviously have had some wonderful mentors and people that have influenced your style and how you do the job. Because one thing about being an artist, there's just so many different paths you can take. And I don't know about you, but I mean, literally, I kind of just kind of cobbled a little bit here and there. From, I mean, my mentor's 93 years old, and he just got laid off from being a cartoonist a couple of years ago, you know, and he's still drawing. So, yeah. But I mean, I've completely ripped off his career because, I mean, he knew how to do it right, and was a cartoonist right up in Knoxville. So talk about that a little bit, and about the people that you've encountered along the way that have helped shape you and help form your career.
Well, first, my grandfather's. Went on about a little bit, but then I had a wonderful professor at USM, a man named Vernon Merrifield, and Vernon was teaching applied art. He was teaching, you know, actually lettering and sign painting and layout and, you know, design and all those things that were necessary to be a commercial artist or an applied artist, and that was my entry. That's where I went. That's what I went to study. And Vernon, for a number of us, you know, a lot of people I know, would guide you. And he sent, I don't know how many of us, over to Tuscaloosa, where he had gone to graduate school to study over there. And, support, constant, you know, encouragement, terrific teacher. I mean, he could get the most out of anybody. And so Vernon was critical, and I think Thornton Willis would say the same, and a number of others. But beyond that, at the University of Alabama, In the graduate program, there's an artist named Mel Price, and Mel Price was among a group that the chairman of the department, Theodore Klitsky, brought down to teach at the University of Alabama, and frankly, largely he recruited these artists to come down and teach for civil rights reasons. They were plugged into the civil rights effort, and Mel Price was a New Yorker. He was an abstract expressionist, and he had shared a studio with Franz Klein, who was, you know, one of the big 10 abstract expressionists of that previous period. So Mel was a great inspiration too. I mean, he could talk with authority about art and the artists that he had worked with and knew, and the artists they'd get drunk together at the Cedar Bar and all that stuff too, which was very interesting. So Mel Price was for me, again, you know, talking to Mel Price and hearing his stories and getting a very human sort of introduction to art on the level that I was working in graduate school, it made it possible, you know? I mean, I think if Mel Price hadn't been a very open and very, you know, very interesting and supportive person, you might think, well, what am I'm not going to do this, you know, this would be out of the question.
Right.
it's just, you know yourself. I mean, it's the odds are not great.
I mean, oh, I know. I mean, well, yeah, I'll have a young student come and say, I want to be a cartoonist. Well, good luck, you know. But I mean,
really?
but you know, also too, I kind of give them a way to be able to do it, you know. And it's like, and now there's, with the internet, it's a different thing. Your journey from, you know, Hattiesburg to Tuscaloosa and then on is fascinating. And it seems like, you know, there's a lot of fate that was lined up there and everything else. But at the end of the day, you just did the work. And it really, well, it's a great story.
It is a lot of luck.
A lot of luck and a lot of work, and definitely great work at that. You're listening to Now You're Talking on MPB Think Radio. I'm your host, Marshall Ramsey, and I'm back with the 2023 recipient of the Governor's Arts Award Lifetime Achievement Honor and also award-winning artist, Ed McGowan. Ed, thank you so much for taking the time today. How are things up in New York? I know there's been a bit of flooding up north of y'all today. And so,
Yeah, we're getting our share.
Well, it's good. We're sending you a little Mississippi weather then.
Okay. All right. I know Mississippi weather up here is, you know, the people, they say they can't, you know, I don't know how you live in a place with that humidity and that da-da-da-da. And I said, listen, I grew up between the Leaf and Bowie River. This is not hard, and and there's no place hotter than Manhattan in the summertime. You know, it. I mean, 95 degrees in Manhattan is really, you're in an oven. So
yeah, those buildings are like charcoal briquettes almost.
Really, they're tough. They really. Are you from Texas?
No, I'm from Georgia originally. Went to school in Tennessee, then lived in Texas. I lived in Conroe, Texas, near Houston, which was like living under a tongue. And then moved out to San Diego, which was like amazing paradise. And I said, you know, I'm really tired of this great weather. So I moved to Mississippi 27 years ago.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Well, you've had a real diet of different taste. Yeah, you sounded so much like somebody I knew from Texas. I would have bet you grew up in Dallas, you know.
Oh, wow, that's cool. No, there's a very hot place. Yeah, no, Dallas is super hot, to say the least. No, you know, yeah. I was out in San Diego, fantastic job, and then I thought, you know, if I'm going to be an editorial cartoonist, I need to go someplace where the politics are really perfect for being an editorial cartoonist. That's why I'm here. So.
That's very interesting. That was a good choice.
It was a good move. Yes, it was. And I love how you ended up going from Tuscaloosa to Washington, D.C. And I would have never thought that moving to Washington would have been literally like somebody cracking open the door of your career in the art scene. But it just seemed to be you hit it just the right time when arts was really exploding up there, right?
That's, well, you're right. I mean, timing's everything. And when I arrived, the Color Field School was emerging, so the famous Morris Lewis and Gene Davis and Howard Merrigan, all that group were just beginning to get a good deal of attention. And coincidentally, it's about the same time that the National Endowment for the Arts started. And that was based in Washington, and they were giving away all the money. So Washington was getting a lot of attention, not only because of the art, but also because of the National Endowment. And everybody came through Washington, to look for grants and meet people and so forth. So it was good timing and a total accident.
Yeah, because you weren't going up there as an artist. You were going to work for a congressman, right?
Exactly. That's right. I was going to go be a flunky for Congressman William Collmer, who was at the time was one of the most, if not the most, powerful congressman in the House of Representatives. He was chairman of the Rules Committee, so you couldn't get any legislation on the floor. You couldn't pass any bills or anything without going through his committee, and he got a lot of. He used that leverage, and I think we can, thank him for those shipbuilding places down on the Gulf Coast and the highways and a lot of other stuff, and that was a fluke. That was my mother, who was a secretary for one of the big supporters for the congressman, overheard the congressman talking to her boss, and he said, you know, I wanted to give this guy, actually one of my classmates, I wanted to give him the opportunity to come and work in Washington. We have this job. It's a patronage job. You know, it's not difficult, and he'll get great experience and whatnot. And he had other plans, so he turned it down. And now I've got to fill this spot, you know, very quickly. And my mother said, I know somebody that will go.
Like a good mom should, yes.
Really, yeah. She stepped up, and at the moment, I was actually teaching at USM, taking you know, covering somebody else who was taking a leave and had an infant baby, and so the school let me out of my contract, and I went up to Washington. Like the Beverly Hillbillies, it was really, you know, a whole new world.
I just had just image of somebody sitting on the back of the truck when the rocking chair when you were up there and ever going up there as well. How were you received when you went up there? Because I mean, I always get people don't think I'm from Texas when I show up somewhere usually, but they're like, "You're from the South, aren't you?" Did you kind of get that? Do you get that kind of impression when you get up there?
Without a doubt. And fortunately for me, Washington is really a southern city.
That is true.
And at the time, the Democrats were very much in control. They the John Kennedy era, and so most of the people that ran things up there, or a great many of them, were southern politicians who had been voted back in year after year after year, and therefore had a lot of seniority and ran the big committees and everything. So I was pretty comfortable in Washington and was accepted, almost instantly. I did my first exhibition was at the Corcoran Gallery of Art there, which is a big gallery.
That's incredible. Museum. Yeah.
And like a country hick I was, I just walked in and said, "Well, I'd like to have an exhibition." They said, "Okay."
Wow.
Not quite like that, but pretty much. So that was great.
Well, obviously, you had a pretty good portfolio along with you. You were doing primarily painting at that point, weren't you?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I was a painter and sort of following Mel Price's his philosophy of painting. I had a huge roll of paintings that I had produced, you know, over 2 or 3 year period.
Yeah, and, I mean, that's the thing. I mean, we do talk about luck a lot, but, you know, at the end of the day, anybody that wants to be an artist, it's really truly about doing the work, and then the luck will show up. But you were just incredibly prolific during that time. You still are.
Very busy and very lucky at the same time, which is not bad.
No doubt.
And Washington was not a big gallery scene. The commercial galleries were almost non-existent in Washington, and a Cuban guy that saw some of my art and bought a picture introduced me to a woman up there. Her name was Henri. She was known as Henri. And she had a gallery over in Virginia, over in Alexandria, Virginia, in Old Town Alexandria. And very much out of the way, you know. I mean, people had to, you know, make a trip to get to Alexandria. And the basis for the gallery, the front for the gallery, was selling not new clothes, vintage clothes, you know, old clothes. And I was just amazed. She was selling all these dead man clothes, I called them, you know. She had, you know, jackets and slacks, whatever, you know, in this little townhouse there. And I couldn't figure it out. And then she had a teeny gallery in the back of all that. But it was a hot spot in that area. I mean, everybody went to her gallery and to see art and so forth. But I discovered later that Henri's secret to success was that she kept a book that had all the notables in Washington had their names, particularly the women. And any time there was, at the end of every season, like Mamie Eisenhower couldn't wear the same ball gown, twice in a row. She'd have an expensive gown, designer gown, and she'd wear it once and then put it aside. And so Henri worked out an arrangement where she would get in touch with the people that had been, to all the big events, and they would give her their clothes, and she knew people all over the U.S. that she thought would be interested in it, and it would fit, it was the right size and all that. And she'd get on the phone and sell Mamie Eisenhower's ball gown to somebody in California,
That is incredible.
It is incredible.
I mean, she knew marketing. She was a great marketer.
That's really great. I mean, she was the widow of a colonel that had been over at the Pentagon in his last years. But anyway, she had this remarkable, ability and remarkable concept, and she took that to put it together and made the gallery, and then eventually dropped that part of it and moved over to D.C. and had a nice, a big space and everything over there, and handled just about all of the interesting Washington artists at one time or another.
So a big part of, obviously, the art scene in Washington and anywhere else is just creating the relationships and being able to make the connections. And you were doing that early. I mean, you did that pretty early on, Washington. And I know that wasn't the only thing you were doing. You were, of course, working the congressional job. You tried your hand at an art school, I believe, as well. And we'll bring that
that's
up quickly.
That's a kind way to put it.
Thank you. I was trying to get through that real quick because I know that probably still stings a little bit after all these years. But
really, my art school didn't last very long, but it served its purpose.
Well, it should have. See, now you should have just been sold dead man's clothes out front. You could have probably made a fortune.
That's right. That's what I should have been doing. Selling dead man's clothes.
Dead man's clothes. That is the funniest thing. And I will never be able to look in a secondhand clothes shop and not think about that. Thank you for planting that little seed into my brain. But, at the end of the day, like you said, Henri had an idea and was able to do something that was unique that ended up doing well. And I thought about that time, was that about the time that you came up with the idea of doing the different personalities to be able, like a writer writing and coming from a different direction to be able to, because I think that's one of the most brilliant ideas that I've heard from an artist, is just to be able to create art from all kinds of different viewpoints.
Well, it was an idea that the germs of that idea were in graduate school, and then it evolved I sort of commit to it by going through that legal name change process where a very good friend of mine who is a lawyer would file a petition to change my name about every 6 weeks. It takes about 6 weeks to run the proper ads in the local papers and all that, so he would file these petitions, and I had given him a list of names, and the whole idea was that you described it exactly as that I intended to work in a sort of a spherical form. If you would imagine a balloon getting bigger and bigger, so that as I added on to the balloon at different places for Thornton Dossett or Alva Foster, whoever I was working with that day, it just got bigger and bigger, as opposed to the linear process, which was terrific. I mean, a great artist, I didn't find anything wrong with it. It just wasn't good for me. But the linear process, where one idea sort of begets the next idea, and there's a logical development, I think it's the logical part that scared me.
Sounds like engineering school all over again, right?
Really, yeah. So I came up with these 12 legal names, and I've, you know, been working pretty hard since then, you know, and creating work under each of these personas concepts, because they're, each one had their own point of departure and concept that I was trying to make fit into the development of art. And these artists were, you know, to some degree or not, were interesting. I think one of them's dead because he hadn't made anything in 25 years.
Yeah, but that would be Nathan Ellis McDuff. Now, that guy's a deadbeat, right? And I saw Oh Freedom. I saw your portrayal of all the different characters, and he looks sketchy. He really does. And I can tell he, you know. So I'm not real surprised that he, you know, either is, like you said, passed away, or he's just completely not doing anything worthwhile now. Because all the others looked very, you know, I could see them creating some great art, but yeah, McDuff, not so much.
Well, yeah, he just didn't appear again. You know, I mean, who knows? I had an acquaintance, or not an acquaintance, but a man I knew who was, I thought, a fabulous artist. Really, one of the most interesting young artists that I was in contact with, and as they say now, he was on the spectrum, and his art was spectacular, but socially he was totally incompetent. He was handicapped, and he couldn't deal with the social part of it, or the other part of it besides just making the art, and he dropped out, and it's always bothered me a lot. I wish I could, you know, see how to find him some way, but I hadn't done it.
Yeah, and I'd say I'm not real surprised. I've known a lot of cartoonists over the years that have kind of been the same way. They were socially awkward probably as kids, and that was their way of having friends. You know, hey, look at me. I can draw this and
really?
So forth
yeah,
on that. And, you know, it's surprising that people are like, Marshall, you actually are comfortable talking to people. What's going on? I was like, well, you know, I know if I'm going to have to live off of my drawings alone, I'm probably going to starve. So I have to kind of figure out some other things. But yeah, that's fascinating on that. And like I said, you being able to have that freedom, and you've been like started in 1969, somewhere in that range. So you've been doing it for a long time. Yeah.
That's about when I started to formalize the process, and I had an exhibition about it at the Baltimore Museum. They fired the curator.
Oh, really? No way.
That was a comment. You know, that was the answer to that.
Oh, wow.
But that name change, you know, has served me well.
Yeah.
And I don't recommend it for anybody else necessarily, but that, for me, I've found that works.
How many times you could have been drafted into the Vietnam War? I mean, I'm just sitting here looking over the names. You're lucky that you didn't get drafted at least six or seven times.
Well, I know, but, you know, married guy with a kid, that, in those days, they weren't drafting people like me.
Yeah, that was gold, I guess, at that point.
So recently, just in the last year or two, these artists are now so old that they have grandchildren. Thornton Dossett had a son. Don't know much about him, but he eventually had a son with his wife. So Thornton Dossett's grandson somehow was in contact with Alva Faust, who had a son, but then Alva's son produced a daughter. And Alva's daughter married Thornton's son. So now the combination of Alva Dossett,
you mix their styles.
That's right. Now I'm working on some work for Alva Dossett that involves things that I've been experimenting with and working on for the last 50 or 60 years.
Okay, that is incredibly fantastic. You're listening to Now You're Talking on MPB Think Radio. I'm your host, Marshall Ramsey. I'm with Ed McGowan. He's the 2023 Lifetime Achievement Governor's Arts Award winner this year. And like I said before, you went in with a great class this time with some great artists. You mentioned Key before. You were in with him. Betsy Bradley, of course, with the Art Museum, Ralph Eubanks. Just talent, talent, talent. But none more deserving than you. Congratulations on that. And we were talking a little bit about the 12 different names that you went for that time. And I love that you had a lawyer, number one, to help you with that. And every 6 weeks you would change. I was just thinking about that. Did you change your car title and all that stuff too at the same time? Okay, because you knew you were going to go back to yourself eventually.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, I was going to close the circle, don't try this without checking it. But I think you can have as many legal aliases as you choose to.
Oh, that's helpful. Yeah. Well, I'm married. Yeah. That might be useful, right? No, I'm just kidding. Yeah. My wife just heard that, and I'm in trouble. Never mind.
Right. But I did have it done legally, and the attorney that did it had been David Smith's, the sculptor David Smith's attorney.
Oh, that's cool.
It before the Supreme Court, which he was very informed about art and everything. Anyway, he was terrific, and it made a big difference. It gave the whole process some gravitas that it wouldn't have had if I had just been doing that privately and not legalizing it somehow.
Well, and I think too that you've put so much effort into creating stories behind the lives of each one, and I love now, like you said, you got their grandchildren getting married or having kids together, and then their talents mixing and so forth. And I'm sure that the grandchildren are watching their grandparents the same way you watched your grandfather.
That's right. Yeah, and my children, I have two daughters down in San Antonio, Texas, and they have, one of them has three children, so I have three grandchildren now that are grown, and I should be a great grandfather by now before, but so far not.
No pressure, though, right?
No pressure.
Well, let me ask you this, because I get asked this all the time. And just for the record, my three boys, none of them draw. They're all very creative, but none of them have any art talent. And my wife's an art teacher. I don't know what happened, but that's okay. Do you have that in your family? Do you have it down? Because my mom was an art teacher and my grandmother was an artist. So, I mean, there's a line of it. But in yours, do your kids have artistic ability? Do your grandchildren have artistic ability?
They do. My oldest daughter is a very competent painter, very good painter. And she has put the brush down from time to time to raise kids and that sort of thing. But now that the kids are grown, she's working again and it's making beautiful things. And my youngest daughter, Jill, is extraordinary writer. I mean, she writes beautifully, beautifully. And so both of them have their areas of creative work, and both of them are very good, and I'm very proud of them. The grandkids are good. One of them is a musician, and the other one is a gifted businessman, which I think is a better idea, really.
Yeah, I mean, I know. I think my dad kind of hoped I went that direction, too. So,
right.
How did you end up in New York? I mean, because I know Washington, obviously, you had a pretty good thing going, but obviously New York and you live in Soho.
Right.
Which I will say probably your neighborhood's a wee bit different now than it was when you first moved to New York.
My shopping center, you mean?
Yeah. And I was about to say, because the last time I went up there, like you said, it is now retail center of the universe.
It really is. That's what's going on here. And I went to New York. I had an opportunity, another, you know, fluke, good opportunity. When my first marriage broke up, and sadly, so I was, you know, on the loose, as I say, and I got an opportunity to live in Paris for a year, and I was given a studio. And I had a successful exhibition, so I had a little money. And so I moved to Paris and had a very good time and learned a lot, I guess. But when I came back to Washington from Paris, Washington was not, you know, didn't have the same charm as Paris.
That is true.
So after a brief turn in Washington again, I decided I would go to New York and see what that was like. And so I've been here pretty much, you know, with my wife and I, who is a New Yorker. I have a mixed marriage. Met a guy from Mississippi and a woman from Astoria, Queens. It's like we're from two different universes, and that's been fun. And so we. You know, we're living now between New York and Miami, and I have a studio. We both have studios. She's an artist. Just had a terrific exhibition that sold out three editions of sculpture. So she's going to be hard to live with for a while. But, you know, but she's a great artist, and so we both have studios in here in New York and work here and at the same place for the last 45 years, actually. And but we have another place down in Miami and a studio down there. So that's becoming, you know, we spend a lot of time in Miami. And during COVID, you know, everything was crazy. And you know,
oh, yeah. New York was terrible. Yeah.
Yeah, it was. I mean, boy, they had bodies in body bags on the street in parts of New York, and so having Miami as a refuge really worked out very nicely, and so we're down then. So anyway, that's the story. You know, it was Washington, Paris, New York.
Yeah,
and at my age, being in. That, you know, when they said you get the Lifetime Achievement Award, a bell really went off.
You're like, oh, wait a minute, I've gotten older. What's going on here? So
really, you're right. I know, it's not over yet, guys. Hang on there.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, you're producing. It was like talking with Key, you know. I mean, he's cranking out some of his best work ever. You're out there. You're still working really hard, too. But I know that had to mean a lot to you to get that phone call. From Mississippi.
It was a big surprise and one of the, certainly without a doubt, you know, one of the most important moments for me. In fact, it was when I was asked, everybody was asked to, you know, give 2 minutes. And when I got behind the podium and, you know, that 85 years of memories started to flash across, you know, my mind, I got very emotional. It was really, I didn't think I was going to get through it. You know, I thought I was going to have to step down, but I mumbled enough to get 2 minutes. And it was a very emotional and very, very, you know, very big honor for me.
And very well deserved. And like I said, this is coming from a guy who literally has stuff in not only in the major museums, but also in corporate headquarters and so forth too, and public art exhibits as well. So you've had an amazing career, and I think that's beautiful that Mississippi recognized that.
Yeah, well, it's deeply appreciated, I must say. And you know, some of the most creative people. I love that newspaper ad. Somebody took out a newspaper because Mississippi is always at the very bottom of the reading scores in all the public schools. You know, it's always traditionally the last or next to last, or, you know, thank God for Alabama, something like that. But somebody put a full-page ad in the New York Times said, we may not be able to read, but we sure can write, and listed all the great literature that's come from Mississippi. And it was quite a list. You know, it was really impressive.
Well, that's what makes the Governor's Arts Award that much better, because you're in the company of giants, and you're a giant yourself. We have 2 minutes. What advice would you give to an up-and-coming artist right now? I know the world has changed a lot since you started out, and now we have AI and all that crazy stuff thrown out there. But what advice would you give to a young man or young woman who is sitting down to try to create a path like you've created?
Well, you know, I am so out of it as a, you know, I couldn't give any advice about anything current. You know, I wouldn't dare, because I'm just not, you know, there are people who are much better at that than I am. But I think that the only thing that really matters is if you like doing it, you know, just somehow work out any way that you can. I had thought of being a fireman. I thought that'd be a great job for an artist, you know.
Yeah.
And I didn't be a fireman. I didn't do that. But find a way to make ends meet, and find a way to be comfortable and happy, as whatever that is, and just make what you make. But keep an eye, do it strategically. Keep an eye on your place in, if keeping an eye on your place in history is too big a leap. Keep an eye on your place in the current movements, and what you, how you fit into it, and how you relate to it, and what sort of a contribution can you make to what's being done, you know, by others. And I think that, you know, with a lot of luck, things will work out.
And I would recommend them Google Ed McGowan too.
Well, I guess they can, there's some stuff on Google.
Yeah, a couple things. I saw a couple of your pictures, so. Hey, this has been a real pleasure. Thank you so much for taking the time today. It's just fun to get to meet you and get to talk to you.
It's my pleasure, I must say. I look forward to seeing some of your stuff, which I'm on the computer right now.
It's easy enough to find. You got to love the Google machine. It's really good stuff. So
it really is.
Well, you stay dry. Good talking to you, and I hope to catch up with you again soon. All right. Thank all of you for listening, and a special thanks to our guest, Ed McGowan, for joining us today. And if you'd like to hear this or any past episodes, subscribe to the podcast on your favorite podcast app or on our MPB Public Media app. Now You're Talking is a production of MPB Think Radio, and with each episode and podcast produced by the incredible, wonderful, and fantastic Jermaine Flood. Join us again next Monday at 10 a.m. I'm Marshall Ramsey. Y'all have a great week.
This is an MPB Think Radio podcast. To hear previous shows, visit mpbonline.org or download the MPB Public Radio app to listen on your iPhone or Android phone on demand.